Should I start?
Yes.
Yes, yes. You can start.
My patient, a 40-year-old lady, Muslim housewife, came with a chief complaint of incontinence of urine since 2 months. Incontinence was complete and continuous, no regular voiding intermittently, no sensation of full bladder, no relieving factors. Leakage was more in standing than in sitting position. Incontinence started 1 month after patient underwent a total abdominal hysterectomy, and patient uses 2 to 3 adult diapers in the day and 1 adult diaper at night.
So who are answering?
Dr. Gopal and Dr. Monish. Gopal is from Pune and Monish is from Bihar.
Okay.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah. Hello, good evening, sir. Monish.
Good evening. So you want to ask any history?
Sir, regarding the urinary complaints, is she having any lower urinary tract symptoms?
You must every time I am telling you, the chief complaint is incontinence. So you must talk, when your first talk should we start with incontinence.
Monish, Gopal, are you understanding what Dr. Jite is saying?
Yes, sir.
See, in the history, when you are taking the history, there are 2 or 3 main symptoms. So first, you find out whether those symptoms has been explained properly or you have got the full history or not.
Yes.
And then, depending on that, in your mind, you are putting some diagnosis or a differential diagnosis. Then depending on that, there should be positive or negative history. But first, you have to find out what is a primary and prime complaint and whether that complaint is complete or not. So in this case, what is a complaint?
Yeah. Incontinence.
So now you want to know everything about incontinence?
Yes.
So Monish, first you tell Dr. Jite and then Dr. Gopal will finish it off.
So... that incontinence, whatever the history they have given, anything more you want to ask about incontinence or about the history of abdominal hysterectomy, because that is very important.
So whether any normal, she voids normally in between and intermittently, there is
no regular voiding intermittently written. No regular voiding.
Whether it is associated with the hematuria,
pyuria. Why you ask in between intermittent voiding?
Sir, since she's giving a history of abdominal hysterectomy, so sir, it may be associated with the urinary urogynec fistula. So in that case, in case of vesicovaginal fistula, there will be a continuous leak without any voids, normal voids in between. In case of uretrovaginal fistula, there will be normal voids in between, plus there will be continuous leak.
Any other condition? Except urotrovaginal fistula.
In between
normal voiding is either present in the urotrovaginal fistula or
overflowing what in a
site and size of the fistula. If the site is very small,
yes,
and in non-dominant area, then the amount of urine required to reach that level in between she may void.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that is one condition, the small fistula and non-dependent area. And another is fistula which involves the partially involves the bladder neck or urethra. Small fistula. Again small fistula. Normal voiding can be possible in such situations, and obviously urge incontinence and stress incontinence is always a differential diagnosis at this stage of the
yes.
So Gopal, Dr. Jite has told you the third condition where the fistula is very small and it is very near to the meatus, urethral meatus. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Why there will be in between continence and intermittent incontinence?
Sir, there is a normal urine output from the other ureter, so that may be the one possibility.
That is ureterovaginal. Yes, that is ureterovaginal fistula that everyone understands. And second thing, what Dr. Gita said is absolutely fine. It is a more of the non-dependent small fistula and the oblique tract. So again, till the bladder, I'm giving you in, till the bladder gets filled up, automatically the fistula will become little bigger. And at the same time, urine will reach to that level and she will pass.
Yes.
Now, what is the reason when this is high fistula, but when it is very near to the meatus, still Dr. Gita has said the same thing is applicable. Why? It is a dependent fistula. Still, patient will be able to pass urine in between. What is the reason?
Sir, the continence mechanism is preserved in that case.
During which part? When the bladder is not full. So she will leak only when the bladder is full and
that
the
is full. Fistula
becomes bigger and the incontinence mechanism, that fibers, they also get elongated.
Yes.
Okay, so that is the reason.
So you have to differentiate, it is a true incontinence or it is a false incontinence.
So now what are the causes of false incontinence? Gopal, can you answer?
Urgency, sir. Overflow incontinence. That's the neurogenic bladder, or the urgency incontinence.
Yes.
Stage incontinence.
Okay. Now, out of this, you can say overactive bladder or small capacity bladder, or as you are saying, neurogenic bladder. Sir. Which things can happen after the surgery?
Sir, stage urinary incontinence can happen after surgery.
Yeah.
Okay. What else? After so many pelvic surgery, what can happen?
The atonic bladder, sir, due to prolonged distension of the bladder.
Okay, if they have not, but most of the time they put the catheter whenever they are doing the pelvic surgery.
Yes, sir. So, sir, after prolonged catheter in situ and sudden removal, the bladder become atonic after the prolonged catheterization.
Usually, the post-gynecological surgery, vaginal fistula either identified intraoperatively within the first 72 hours or after the removal of catheter. These are the three things. Intraoperatively, if it is identified, it is well and good. The most common timing of identification is first post-operative.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Post-operative fistula get manifest early in the 48 to 72 hours of the period after the removal of the catheter, and this obstructive labor induced fistula, they manifest late, after 2 to 3 weeks or the months.
Hello.
Yeah, sir.
And post obstetric fistula are always after the 7 to 10 days. Why?
Because post obstetric fistula, due to the ischemic necrosis of the vaginal mucosa and tissue, that takes the
why there is ischemic necrosis.
Sir, Dr. Gita has asked you a very simple question. You have to say what are the causes of post-operative fistula, or what are the causes of damage to the bladder during surgery? What are the causes? Tell us.
One may be direct inadvertent injury to the bladder while hysterectomy. Okay. There is a clotting injury.
No. Listen. If he is asking the causes of the vaginal fistula, then you have to divide it into the gynecological, non-gynecological, obstetric, and
Dr. Gita, that you have already said. So I am asking them that during surgery, what are the causes which can damage the bladder and patient will develop fistula during surgery?
Okay.
Understood. So what is the gynec and so first we are going for a gynec. Okay.
Or maybe the cautery injury. May cause the tissue necrosis and ischemia. So other is inadvertent passage of suture while closure of the vaginal vault. If the suture passes through the bladder, then it may cause a fistula.
And have you assisted some gynecologist? for doing the hysterectomy once in a while?
You start from step number one. After first opening, step, what they do first?
First step they will do, what they will do? They will do a separation of bladder from the uterus vigorously.
Okay. Yes.
By blood dissection using the finger, gauze or swab and whatever available there.
Yes.
And that tears in the posterior bladder wall. Okay, while that over vigorous blood dissection result into the tear into the posterior bladder wall, and which hour it will devascularize the posterior bladder wall if it is not tear, and ultimately that end up into the fistula. That is the first part.
The first part. Okay.
Yes.
Second.
Second, sir, cautery injury.
Okay.
Which may cause the necrosis later.
Why there is a cautery injury?
Because it's a close proximity of the
where they will use cautery.
So while separating the bladder and the uterus,
they use cautery.
While controlling pelvic bleeding, while controlling pelvic bleeding, inadvertent damage can occur if there is a blood loss. At that time, the tissue prints.
Not only that, even if while separately, Dr. Dite has told you, when they are doing the surgery, they are separating the bladder. Now, there are some gynecologists, 90% of them, they use gauze piece or they something and they want the bladder to go down. Okay? Yes. During that time, the serosa will remain behind and the blood supply, means the bladder wall will become thin, the blood supply will be affected. Same way, there are some gynecologists who will try to do the scissor. They will use scissor and they can go between the layers of serosa, not between the bladder and the uterus up to the cervix, but instead of that, they go into the layers of bladder and they will affect. Now, during all these things, there may be some bleeding from the bladder wall and they'll try to cauterize it. And that is a time they will damage it by cautery, or as you are saying, there may be some other bleeding which is very near to the bladder and that cautery can affect it. Now, what is the other reason of cautery nowadays in today's world?
Harmonic, sir.
Laparoscopy.
Use of harmonic.
What you mean is laparoscopy. A laparoscopic surgery.
Yes,
so that they use. Yes, Dr. Gita, you wanted to say something.
Yes, sir. So this first cause is well described and explained. Another, whatever these people were telling is all this theoretical part. Practically, when you assist the gynecologist, the second site where they damage the bladder is during the closure of the vault.
Yes.
Because while closing the vault, they will take some part of the bladder in that stitch. And after 48 hours to 72 hours, that stitch will cause a tissue necrosis of the bladder. So,
yes.
Usually the post-hysterectomy fistulas are supratrigonal. These are the reasons. Because the most commonest reason for forming the fistulas while doing the gynecological hysterectomy is first the separation of bladder from the uterus, one, and another is during the closure of the wall. So these are always fistulas are always at the supratrigonal area or always above the interuretric bar. That is the reason why these are there. Okay.
Many times you do scopy, you see the stitch. What Dr. Gide is saying, when we do scopy, we see the stitch in the bladder.
Yes. So this is for gynecological. Another is obstetric part. So tell me obstetric, why fistula will form in obstetric, what are the obstetric causes for formation of fistula?
Sir,
ask you a very specific question.
In case of the cephalopelvic disproportion, in case of the CPD, short stature, this female patient and the prolonged labor.
What are the different ways of delivering the baby?
Sir, it can be normal vaginal delivery, it can be assisted vaginal delivery, or it can be cesarean section. In the normal vaginal delivery, if there is a prolonged labor and the patient is having the pelvic disproportion and the short stature, then there are, or the fetus is large, or the there is a different position, a different life in this position, then it can cause the prolonged labor and that can cause the tissue damage due to the necrosis, and that will lead to the fistula after the ischemic necrosis. Or there can be a fistula in the forceps delivery, in which there is a use of the high pressure. At that time also, it can damage the vaginal mucosa, and it can damage. Or after the cesarean section also, it can injure while dissecting the bladder, as in the other surgeries.
So, what is the difference between two fistula?
Sir,
normal delivery and cesarean section.
Sir, in the normal delivery, in the prolonged labor, the large amount of area can be damaged with the fetal head. So, that can be large fistula. And in the cesarean section,
where
it can
be
small.
It will be around the bladder neck area. Bladder. Where the pressure will be the maximum.
Right. Why? Why at the bladder neck area?
Sir, because the fetal head is engaged at the pubic symphysis.
So most important thing is it is between the two hard surfaces.
Yes.
Understood. Why? Yes. And what is the one of the cause? One is prolonged labor and all these things. What is the another thing?
So very young patient.
No. What is the another thing?
Sir,
usually it will not happen in our big hospitals, but in a small town.
Untrained dais doing delivery. At the home deliveries, these are
What else?
Sir, neglected obstructive labor. After many hours.
I agree with you. That is true. But what is the contributing factor in that? What happens to bladder when there is a prolonged labor?
Yes.
And if you don't drain it, what will happen?
Not catheterizing the bladder, that causes the over distension of bladder. And that will cause the more damage.
And what happens to the wall?
Wall gets thin out, sir.
Exactly. And that is the reason, the one of the contributing factor along with this, in many cases we have seen that patient, they have undergone prolonged labor in small village or in their house or somewhere earlier. And nowadays you don't see so many. Earlier we used to see. So this is one of the contributing. And second thing, tell me what happens during cesarean section.
Sir, the stretching of the bladder while separating.
What is the long form of cesarean section? What you write down in your exam or in your paper?
Lower segment cesarean
section. Lower segment cesarean section. So what happens? How they do lower segment? Uterus is so big.
Yes.
So why they do lower segment cesarean section? What is the meaning of lower segment? It is one of the most vascular, it means least vascular area.
Yes, and the placenta is situated on the upper segment. So mostly they
low-lying placenta.
Exactly. Yes. No. So they do at a lower segment cesarean section. So what is adrenaline at that point?
If they extend the incision laterally while they take the horizontal.
First of all, they have to separate the bladder. Even though uterus is so big, the bladder is adherent to that part. Okay? So, they have to separate before going to the lower segment. So, that is the reason. So, in that case, fistula will be low or high?
It will be low-lying fistula, sir.
Very good. Higher. What type of fistula will develop?
Sir, trigonal fistula.
But what type of fistula it will be? It will be a vasico-vaginal fistula?
It will be vasico-vaginal fistula.
Will it be vasico-vaginal fistula?
Actually, utero-vaginal will be.
Exactly. You can say vasico-vaginal. Usually, it is involving the either cervical part or the. So, you may get vasico-uterine, you may get vasico-cervical-vaginal fistula.
Okay, sir.
And so this fistula is the highest. As Dr. Gitesh told you, no?
Yes.
Right? It will be a very high fistula.
So, same question. If you answer like this, the causes of obstetric causes for vasico-vaginal fistula are either prolonged obstructed labor, number one. Number two is trauma. Trauma may be due to the instrumental delivery or due to the lower segment cesarean section. Okay. These are the only three causes. again that LS case, yes. Multiple subheadings are there. And as far as the cephalic pelvic disproportionation and mal presentation, you must know ki why there is a delayed presentation of incontinence. So someone has explained already ki the trigone of the bladder is crushed between the pubic symphysis and presenting part of the fetus, which will causes ischemia to the ischemia and tissue necrosis of the trigone of the bladder. That's left out after 7 to 8 days. That is the reason why incontinence develops after 7 to 8 days.
Yes.
Okay. So these are the causes for obstetric causes. What are the other causes for VVF? Yes.
Other may be TURBT or vaginal.
See, now you divided the causes, right? You said gynecological causes, you said obstructive causes.
Yes.
So why don't you follow the classification? Say so, surgical causes, then say
sir, now these are non
radiation. Surgical causes, what are the surgical causes of fistula?
Hysterectomy, sir. It can be the
vaginal hysterectomy. Come under gynec, no. What are the surgical causes? Surgical causes.
The surgical will be, sir, any stress incontinence surgery or
so say pelvic surgery. URBT. Pelvic surgeries. Yes, so first, pelvic surgeries. First you divide it into open and then into laparoscopic and this thing, na, endoscopic. So yes. Anterior corpolaphy, for example, pelvic surgeries for incontinence.
Corposuspension.
Colpo suspension, then they will do some malignancy surgeries.
Radiation also.
Radiotherapy.
That comes under the next classification. First was gynecological, then you said obstetric. Now you are telling surgical causes. Yeah. Surgical causes, open surgery as well as laparoscopic and endoscopic surgery. In endoscopic surgery, TURBT, blah, 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 all those other things. Then you go to the next one, radiation. Then you go to malignancies.
Yes.
Then you go to trauma.
Foreign bodies also can.
Foreign bodies. So that but is how you classify.
What? Also infection or inflammation.
Correct. Inflammatory. So when you are following that classification, answer in the similar way.
CA cervix, sir. CA cervix.
Very good. So that is under malignancy.
Yes.
So CA cervix, CA vagina, CA bladder.
CA bladder.
Why there is VVAP in post radiotherapy patients?
Sir, there is delayed ischemia and endarteritis, so which causes the ischemia and necrosis of the tissue.
Obliterative endarteritis after the prolonged period.
So when usually it is usually after how many years, month?
Six month to year, sir. The radiation induced fistula appears after 6 month to 1 year of the radiotherapy.
1 to 2 years.
Yes.
Mean what are the infective causes?
Infective, it may be pelvic inflammatory disease.
Vaginal
endometriosis, endometriosis also.
Vaginal foreign body.
Yes, sir.
Genital tuberculosis.
Genital tuberculosis.
Lymphogranuloma venorum. Yes. Very, very rarely actinomycosis.
Chronic diseases.
Yes. So these are the causes for VVF. So we'll go ahead with again history. What history you want to ask?
So regarding the hysterectomy, so what was the indication for the hysterectomy and how much time the surgery lasted?
I'll tell you.
Complications intra-op during the surgery, any bleeding?
Yes, telling everything. So negative history, not associated with any pain, dysuria, LUTS, lithuria, pyuria, hematuria, no fever, no vomiting, no weight loss, malaise, cough, jaundice, loss of appetite, no discharge from the vagina, patient is sexually active till 6 months back. And family was complete. So this is the details of the total abdominal hysterectomy, which was done by open method on 18th of June 2019. No oophorectomy was done that time. A drain was placed. The hysterectomy was done for polymenorrhagia, and the uterus had a fibroid on sonography, which was 2 by 45 centimeters. Post-operative cause, the patient had a wound infection with induration and mild purulent discharge, for which IV antibiotics were given, Monocef. Once the infection subsided and induration had decreased, the stitches were removed on post-op day 18. Histopathology of the specimen showed benign endometrial polyp with adenomyosis, no cellular atypia or malignancies, and mild chronic cervicitis. And this is the OT notes. There is basically it was all uneventful, but you can just read it. It was done under spinal anesthesia, the surgery.
Sir, so how long the catheter
final
was
anesthesia has got Monish, final yes. anesthesia and general anesthesia, does it have any effect on the surgery?
Sir,
yes, Gopal.
Sir, it will cause the vasodilatation in the spinal anesthesia.
So what?
So tone will be more bleeding. Tone will be reduced. Tone will be reduced. Bleeding will be more.
So what happens to the relaxation?
Smooth muscles are
kind of asking, is there any struggle?
Muscles are relaxed.
In which anesthesia it will be relaxed?
As in general anesthesia with relaxation, it will be very relaxed. So the exposure yes. will be better.
Very bulky uterus and they have given a yeah. spinal and they have tried to do from which incision? Vertical incision or phalangeal?
Phalangeal.
So what will happen?
Difficult in the exposure of the...
So there are chances. So they might have to struggle sometime if it is a very big
yes.
fibroid. So in such cases, if it is given a general anesthesia, you can presume that the struggle was yes. little less. Yes, Dr. Githu, you wanted to ask something.
Yes. So after knowing all these things, what else you want to ask about?
The duration of the catheter.
Do you want to ask about the prior history, before history of anything?
Yes, sir.
What?
So history of any incontinence preoperatively?
No.
Before that, how many children she had?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I'm coming to that. So, known case of hypertension and diabetes on regular treatment, bowel appetite normal, no addictions, family history not significant. Post hysterectomy status, so at present no menses. Before the hysterectomy, they were regular, but...
What I want to say is, does she had any prior gynecological surgery?
No, only three full-term normal deliveries. Three.
Yeah, does she had that all... full-term normal deliveries or abdominal or vaginal deliveries or home deliveries or hospital deliveries. All things are important. Does it require sometime to instrument delivery or forceps delivery? Prior history, before hysterectomy.
Yes,
so
sir.
All these things are also important.
Yes, sir. Three full-term normal deliveries. No LSCS, no other
history. So three full-term normal vaginal hospital deliveries or home deliveries. As I ek sentence mein bol.
Okay, sir. So hospital deliveries.
Okay. No. So now one has to ask about the incontinence.
Sir, history of catheterization after the surgery. It was how long
Yes. That is.
And for what period she was having continence after the hysterectomy?
So that is written. She developed incontinence since 2 months. Basically, incontinence started around 1 month after.
Same. Not interested after how many months she starting the incontinence. The time of occurrence, first occurrence of incontinence.
Yes.
Duration of the catheter. Is it immediately after the catheter removal? Or in between some month or 2 months she is passing normally and then she developed incontinence?
No, he was passing urine normally after this wound infection and everything happened. After that, around 1 week later, she developed incontinence. And catheter was removed during the hospital only on day two.
So after discharge, 1 month, she is normal?
Yeah. Yes, except this
wound infection.
Yes, but urinary complaints wise, she was normal.
So that means she doesn't have incontinence.
Yes, sir. No incontinence.
Yes.
Okay. So suppose, what are the probable causes in such situations?
So the wound infection they have mentioned.
It is a delayed presentation in spite of having a gynecological cause.
Yes.
So the infection which was mentioned, was it a superficial infection or it was a deep infection involving the visceral structure?
Too much details we don't have because it was in another hospital, but we know that the patient said there was purulent discharge and there was a lot of redness and all that, and she had to be given IV antibiotics.
Yes.
And Motisef is mentioned on discharge card. But stitches were moved on day 18, very late. But most probably it was not a disinfection.
So the probable cause for what I feel in this case is quadri injury is not that much.
Quadri injury, yes, sir. Yes.
I doesn't think quadri injury is not delayed up to 2 months. It will lead
deep surgical infection.
Secondary infection, and probably he or she who is doing the hysterectomy may have taken a stitch while doing the hysterectomy of the with bladder. That is probably the cause.
Yes.
And as Dr. Gita has mentioned, this stitch sometimes it may not be through and through. So
yes, partial, you know, also. Yes, yeah. It will take some time.
And yes, so that is why it has taken a little longer time.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. What else you want to ask? So the time of occurrence, then the timing of leakage, then the timing of leakage means it is a total continuous 24 hour or in between, only in lying down position or in standing position, or voiding per urethra, in between voiding to tumne pooch le, then amount of leakage, only a few drops or continuous pull, continuous.
Yes, two to three pad per day, sir. She is telling in the history.
Two to three pad per day means what? The rest of the urine, where it is going?
No, sir, two to three adult diapers.
So it's okay then. Pad means it's very small amount, no? Only one.
Yes.
Yes.
Any history of any fecal matter or the gases from the urine she was passing?
So you are suspecting some systemic cause, systemic disease which involves the urinary system as well as the
Do you think that symptom will be involved and patient will present after 1 month?
Yeah.
So sometimes small rectum.
If rectum is involved, your patient will present much quickly. It cannot be after 1 month.
Post hysterectomy, rectourethral rectovesical fistula is very, very rare.
Yes.
Until and otherwise, that surgeon is not too good. So, what else? What else is you want to ask?
Pain, any abdominal pain, perineal pain.
Pain,
dyspareunia.
Ask, everything is asked. No associated pain, dysuria, LUTS, lithuria, pyuria, immaturia, fever, nothing. And patient was sexually active till 6 months back. After she started developing all these symptoms of polymenorrhagia and all, she was not sexually active.
Oh. Examination.
Last question, you will take the examiner towards rectovaginal fistula and systemic causes and other things.
Yeah. Central examination, should I go ahead, sir?
Yeah, please.
Responsive, cooperative, well-oriented in time, place and person. Performance score is 90, pulse is 80, PP 130 by 90 per minute. Respiratory rate is 18 per minute, afebrile, no pallor, aqueous cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or edema, skull, spine, normal. Systemic examination per abdomen on inspection, abdomen is flat, no visible sinuses, dilated veins, no pulses. Scar of previous surgery is now healthy. Palpation, my findings of inspection were confirmed on palpation, superficial palpation, there is no raised temperature or tenderness. Abdomen is soft, non-tender, no lump, no organomegaly, scar is healthy. On percussion, there is no free fluid. On pervaginal examination, patient has no discharge. There is a post-hysterectomy status, empty hold. Induration is felt at the of the finger on the anterior vaginal wall with a tinge of blood on returning finger. Per speculum examination, vaginal mucosa normal. There is evidence of pooling of urine in the vagina. There is no discharge or growth. There is no cystocele or rectocele. There is mild induration seen on the upper part of the anterior vaginal wall. There is on DRE, perianal sensations are well present. Anal sphincter tone is normal. Rectum is empty. Mucosa is free. Bulbocavernosus reflex is present.
Yeah. Yes,
sir. So in perspeculum examination.
So So on general examination, one must tell that there is no evidence of pruritus, vulva like things, or skin irritation, or skin changes, because it will cause the skin irritation and the multiple small ulcerations like lesions in the perineal area. That is one thing. For abdomen, one has to tell about the scar. It is well healed scar, irregularly healed scar.
Well healed scar.
Then on vulval examination or PS per speculum and per vaginal, both examination one has to do. So vulval examination, is there any water discharge per vagina, and what is the smell of that discharge? If it, whenever there is a small amount of leaking, then it may be something else. That if it is an immediate postoperative period, it may be peritoneal fluid, it may be ascites, or n number of causes. So that fluid should have ammoniacal smell.
Okay.
And the excoriation of vulva or perineal tear may be present. Sometimes perineal tear may be present because not duration is not too big. Only if it is the examination is within the some short duration of the hysterectomy.
Yes.
For speculum examination, again, pulling of the fluid in the vagina, already see told. Then, if it is possible to see the site and size of the induration, redness of the vaginal vaginal mucosa, plus tissue mobility, then the condition of the surrounding tissue of the vagina. And sometimes, when there is a large bladder fistula, then the bladder mucosa may seem prolapsing through the vaginal examination. That may be possible sometimes. So these all things in toto, one has to tell in abdominal per speculum examination and per vaginal examination.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
So this was the induration was very small and no specific opening could be felt, and rest of all mucosa was normal.
Yes.
And ammoniacal smell was there. In the fluid.
Yes.
So you want to go ahead, Monish?
Monish, yeah. Any question?
What would you like to do now?
Monish, I'm asking you a direct question. Dr. Kite has told you, will you like to ask anything in per vaginal examination?
So the vagina is roomy or it is atrophic.
Very good. Why it is important?
So if you're planning per vaginally, if you're planning the repair of the fistula, then the vagina needs to be roomy and capacious.
Otherwise, it is contraindicated. Correct?
Yes. And the status of the mucosa.
Yeah, that is okay. So, what is the status of the mucosa? I want to know.
So, whether it is healthy, it's distensible, and the area around the fistula, whether it is fibrotic or is there any infection, inflammation, or
it is supple or scarred, we have to see.
Yes, and whether it is adherent, mobile or not. That is most important thing. Na?
Yes. Because
you will decide in your mind what type of surgery you want to do.
Yes. Yeah.
So here you are suspecting, what is your diagnosis now?
Monish, what is your diagnosis?
So it's probably a vesico-vaginal fistula.
Okay.
Second diagnosis will be vesico-vaginal with a uretero-vaginal or a uretero-vaginal fistula.
It says in between normally wording?
No, sir.
So it cannot be only uretero-vaginal fistula, correct?
So it may be associated. Yeah. The VVF may be associated
like
with
the VVF. First two I accepted. Third, what you are telling, only uretero-vaginal fistula.
That is not accepted.
Yes.
You have to be very clear.
Yes.
So, how will you confirm your diagnosis? Okay, you are telling VVF and VVF plus UVF. Any other diagnosis you want to tell? Differential
sir,
someone has asked about solitary kidney, but we already have done sonography before.
Yes, no previous surgery or nothing.
Previous surgery. So, we know it that patient had two kidneys.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
what are
the investigations? Gopal, can you tell us?
Sir, we want to do this diet test.
Yeah, what are the investigations you would like to do now?
Start with the complete blood count and urine routine. And if urine routine is showing pustules, then we'll go ahead with culture. And sir, serum creatinine and So the site of the fistula is not confirmed yet. So I'd like to confirm it with sir, a VCUG with the lateral
fistula. So that's what I asked you. How will you confirm your diagnosis?
Yes, sir.
Parallelly, you have to do whatever you are telling also. That is urine routine, urine culture sensitivity is required. Start the antibiotic if she is running the fever.
Yes.
For confirmation of the fistula, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 non-invasive, invasive test, radiological, non-radiological, you have to tell him. Check.
First is the ultrasound, ultrasound abdomen with the pelvis, we want to do.
Any dilatation of the urethra. What information you will get?
Sir, any dilatation of the ureter or the kidney?
Very good. Hydronephrosis, hydroureter.
Yeah. So the status of the bladder.
Yes.
Any associated pathology of the bladder?
What else?
Any urinoma, if it is
urinoma, any perivesical collection.
Very good. Fine. So these are the important things.
Yes.
So we want to do sonography.
Someone is telling urine how urine routine is reliable in the patient of UVF.
So actually, there are chances of contamination because we are collecting the urine from the vagina. So there are more chances of contamination.
No, no. If it is a large size fistula and if it is totally passing through the vagina only, if it is not passing a drop of urine periodically, then it's true. But when it is small fistula, then if she is passing in between, or we can, if it is possible to place the catheter and collect the urine sample, then it's like normal one.
Yes.
Yes. So the urine routine showed traces of albumin. It was slightly hazy. There was RBC 85 to 90 present per high power field, and pus cells 25 to 30 per high power fields, and epithelial cells 8 to 10. Hemoglobin 13.3, TLC 11,820, platelet count adequate, sodium potassium normal, creatinine 0.66, INR 0.98, and rest of coagulation profile within normal limits. We did not do a sonography because before the hysterectomy sonography was there. So we have done straight away CT scan with urography. And my
diagnosis of the vasovaginal fistula, nowadays the people were directly doing the CT IVP plus CT cystography delayed case. Okay.
Yes, sir.
In majority of the centers. Particularly in prior check. If examiner is old, then he may be interested in diet test, double diet test, triple diet, triple swab test, and n number of tests. So that you must know.
Okay.
Plus, conventional CT IVP and micturating cystourethrography. Again, that is the one thing we people are also doing before doing the CT IVP plus CT cystography. So one must know what is the role of IVP, what is the role of VCUG, why it is replaced by CT and CT cystography, where is the role of three swab test. These all things you must know. So we will go one by one. You wait here. What is meant by dye test?
Monish?
Sir, dye test, instill intravesical methylene blue, and orally we give sir pyridium. And we place three swabs in the vagina.
Only dye test. Only dye test.
Only dye test.
So we instill a intravesical methylene blue, and we do a per-speculum vaginal examination.
Yes, that is.
We see for the blue dye in the vagina.
What is by three swab test?
As in three swab test, we instill intravesical methylene blue, and orally we give the patient pyridium, and we place three swabs in the vagina at three levels, at the proximal part, the mid part, and distal part of the vagina. And
In three swab test also, we either give pyridium or we may not give pyridium.
Yes.
Okay, because that three swab test is also called as a tempun test of Muir.
Tempun test.
Yes.
Yeah. So if middle swab is get blue, then it is test of
vasovaginal
fistula. If upper swab is wet and rest of the swab is dry,
yes,
then it is
urethrovaginal.
Yeah, and if the lower swab is blue, then it is called as
urethrovaginal.
Urethrovaginal fistula. Now the third test is double diet test. Tell me, double diet. Same thing, but giving the pyridine.
So if the upper swab is wet as well as orange, the rest of the swabs are dry, then same, it is a ureterovaginal
infection. Same conclusion, except the upper thigh is, in spite of wet, it is orange color.
Orange color.
Okay. So these are the some tests required for confirmation.
Yes.
What is the role of now IVP, IVP and cystography?
Sir, to diagnose the confirm the diagnosis in the equivocal cases with the delayed film of the
why IVP? IVP, sir, the role of IVP and CT IVP is one and same near about.
It is to exclude the concomitant ureterovaginal
diagnosis of ureterovaginal fistula.
10% patient have the ureterovaginal fistula along with the BVF.
Yes, here we are not going into the details of what are the advantages of CT scan over IVP. No,
yes.
Here we know everything. Earlier also we have discussed so many times.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
So here we are interested only to find out why you want to do CT IVP or plain IVP.
Yes.
So then, CUG indication. N number of centers still in India were doing a VCUG as a primary diagnostic investigation in spite of CT IVP and CT cystography. Okay, so you must know each thing about the VCUG. But and how many films are to be taken, plain film, distant bladder, full film, lateral film, post film, then what are the findings? You must know it.
Yes. So in the per speculum examination, we are not able to find the fistula opening, or we are in doubt that whether it is a fistula or some other pathology. So just to confirm the fistula, we can do a VCU.
Otherwise, what you will do? Suppose there is no CT scan in your hospital.
We can do a VCUG and then we'll do a cystoscopy and confirm the bladder opening. And also we'll do a RGP in the same setting to rule out the ureterovaginal.
Agreed, but for the diagnosis of vesic vaginal fistula, VCUG or cystography, these are the only two things, plus always cystoscopy.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now CT IVP and CT cystography report.
So sorry, but I don't have films of this.
No issue.
Okay, so the right kidney, everything is normal. Left kidney is normal except for a 3 mm calculus in the mid pole. Perinephric fat planes are normal. Uterus not visualized. Post hysterectomy status. There is a small heterogeneously enhancing uterine stump seen. The urinary bladder is distended with mild diffuse wall thickening. There is an abnormal small fistulous compartment of 3 mm diameter between the posterior wall of the urinary bladder and the anterior wall of vagina or uterine stump, with extravasation of excreted contrast from the urinary bladder into the vagina with its resultant distension. There is no extravasation of contrast from the terminal ureters and no periuretric collection. Distal ileal loops in the pelvis show mild bowel wall thickening and accentuated bowel wall enhancement. There is minimum free fluid and focal adherence of ileum to the uterine stump is seen.
Yes. So, Monique, now,
yes.
Most important thing, now what you want to do, and after that, what you will plan, and what is the, you know, how will you find out whether this patient will do good in your hands or you will have to struggle? So these are the things. Now tell us.
First, it is a vesicovaginal fistula. There is no ureterovaginal component.
Okay.
And secondly, so the fistula is small in diameter. It is 3 mm in diameter.
Okay.
So, and, so as far as the size of the fistula is concerned, CT is confirmatory, or do you want to do again confirm with
cystoscopy? Sir, we want to do cystoscopy.
Cystoscopy will be confirmed.
Because if it is a straight fistula, straight tract fistula, the size may be confirmatory. Okay, when it is oblique fistula, sometimes the entry and exit point may be of different size.
Yes.
Okay. In such situation, we have to do a cystoscopy, and in cystoscopy, what are the things? You completely answer first sir's question. We'll later on discuss the cystoscopy.
So in cystoscopy, you will see the
answer the sir's question. Continue. Yes. What sir has asked?
So first of all, now you saw that on CT scan it is showing 3 millimeter fistula, but yes, you cannot be 100% sure of the size. But yes. What you can see is whether the tract is straight sometime, or it is long tract, or it is obliterated. I mean, oblique tract that you can see on the lateral films. And yes, sometimes it is a very good CT scan. They can do the three-dimensional build-up of the CT, and they can give you all the information.
Yes.
But apart from that, what we like to do is to do a cystoscopy.
Cystoscopy.
So now we are going to show you cystoscopy. After that, you tell us what are the chances of this fistula, get repaired very easily with difficulty, and what are the chances of recurrence? Okay.
Yes.
So before telling the findings of cystoscopy, what you want to see? You tell.
What you want to see in
cystoscopy? Cystoscopy will see the site of the fistula. We'll see the number of the fistulas, and so relation with the ureteric opening. How far is it from the ureteric opening? And
It should be in one go. Size,
and association with the
surrounding mucosa irregularity, redness,
yes,
bullous edema, then the number, then proximity to the ureteric opening. In one go.
Yes.
Presence of foreign body.
Yes, presence of foreign body. So,
whether it is supratrigonal, trigonal, or very near to the meatus. Yes. And whether it is involving urethra or not. So start from urethra. Start from urethra. So you can start from urethra. Watch what Dr. Gita has told you. Can we earlier film?
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes, Gopal.
Just for to explain, this is a trigone, okay? If you, okay. Can you see the arrow?
Yeah.
This is a trigone.
So we'll see the trigone, we'll see the ureteric opening.
Gopal, you are answering. Yes. Please answer. Start from the site of fistula, whether it is supratrigonal, trigonal, or see when you enter inside, first you'll see urethra, you'll see trigone, and whether any fistula is seen or not. So first start with that.
So it's a supratrigonal fistula.
It is number one. So you will find out whether it is supratrigonal, trigonal, or very near to the urethra. Okay, yes. Or whether it is involving the urethra or not. Second thing.
Yes. The second, the number, it's looking like a single fistula.
Yeah,
though I don't have the.
Okay, yeah. So the second thing you want to see is number. Very good. Third thing.
As a size of the fistula, it is looking quite small in size, about 5 millimeters.
How will you find out the size?
So we can see by the diameter of, we can compare the diameter of the scope which we are using.
No, how will you? Gopal, can you tell us?
Beak of the cystoscope, sir.
Can you see the beak of the cystoscope?
Six French ureteric catheter, see whether it is.
Very good. Either see. Like in a tumor, how you can find out the size of the tumor? By loop. Loop is 1 centimeter. Now, yes, suppose if you really want to see, you can put your resectoscope. You can see. But otherwise, as Dr. Hiren Soda is suggested you, the most important thing is ureteric catheter.
Yeah, sir.
Yes.
You can ultimately are going to pass the ureteric catheter to see. So
yes,
that is number one. Number three, size of the fistula. Then
yes. So relation with the ureteric orifice.
Very good.
So it is looking quite far away from the orifice.
Number four. Number five.
So the condition of the mucosa surrounding the opening, whether it is fibrotic, so it's looking healthy.
Tell me what is meant by immature fistula and what is meant by mature fistula on cystoscope.
In mature fistula, there will be the epithelialization of the complete tract,
right.
And the immature fistula, maybe there is inflammation or
mature fistula means the mucosa is smooth, doesn't look like angry looking mucosa, smooth margin. With variable size defect. And in immature fistula, there is a localized bullous edema of the mucosa.
Edema, yes.
Okay. with indistinct ostium or indistinct opening of the fistula. That is called as immature fistula. Because that is important. Before going to surgery, this fistula should be mature.
Yes.
Fine. So, very good. Anything else you like to do?
Ureteric jets, ureteric jet.
Yeah, ureteric jets were normal. And
anything else? Anything else before that about fistula?
Sir, we can do RGP and see whether.
It's later on.
But sir, CT scan is already done. So.
Anything else you want to know about fistula?
The fistula track, whether it is
it's oblique or straight.
How will you do
can
it?
You can pass a guide wire or a ureteric catheter if it allows through the fistula.
And
best is guide wire because ureteric catheter may cause another false passage.
Yes.
So then
and take the film.
You pass the guide wire and then if you want more that you can pass the ureteric catheter and you can see. How will you see it?
Under the CM.
You can see under the fluoroscopic guide. CM.
No, very difficult.
Per vaginal.
Per vaginal, you see the guide wire coming out. You hold it, both the hands and see. If it is straight, it will be continuous U-shape. But if it is not straight, you will be able to see where is the fistula in cystoscopy and from vagina, from where it is coming, whether it is oblique or not.
Yes.
So, two, three practical problems I will tell. If the clinically patient is leaking and intra on cystoscopy there is no obvious visible fistula. Okay. In such situation, the causes are if the fistula's opening is in spite of having the rounded opening, that is U-shaped opening. Okay. And while seeing from the bladder neck, it will look like a small pit. In that pit, guide wire is difficult. So that is one of the indications for the vaginoscopic assessment of the fistula. One. If there is no fistula seen, vaginoscopically as well as cystoscopically, still it is leaking. Then there is indication for RGP. Suppose RGP is also normal. When it is possible, when the fistula is at the level of intramural ureter. Usually caused by while doing the laparoscopic. The fistula site and RGP look like normal.
Yes.
In such situation, we have to go for ureteroscope. That is the last resort. And in spite of that, if there is no fistula and still it is clinically leaking, in such situation, we have to open the patient iodine to 3% and with 100% success, dissect in between the vagina and bladder thoroughly. And just place the omentum and so as far as now it is a simple fistula or complex fistula?
This is a simple fistula.
Why it is simple fistula? What are the criteria saying that it is a simple fistula?
Yes, sir.
Site of the fistula is supratrigonal, size is a small. There is no scarring.
Small means how much?
Less than 4 centimeters.
Very good. Okay.
Not associated with the radiation.
No. Size is again small, medium and large and extensive.
Yes.
Small is less than 2 centimeters. Medium is 2 to 3 centimeters. Large is 5 centimeters. And extensive is more than 6 centimeters.
Yes.
So small size means less than 2 centimeters.
2 centimeters.
Continue your answer.
Yes.
Sir, any history of previous failed surgeries, the complex fistula, multiple fistula, fistula associated with radiation or the infection, these are the complex type fistula.
In this case, you talk, no, small it is, there is no grand.
It is small, it is a supratrigonal.
You told it is a small fistula.
There is no much scarring seen, there is no foreign body seen.
Yes.
And track there up is no, fistula to mature.
There is no much tissue loss, the mucosa is healthy.
Supratrigonal, less than 2 centimeter, healthy tissue, good access, single fistula. That's all.
Yes, sir.
So you know now what is simple fistula? Okay, Monish,
in one sentence,
can you tell us what are the complicated fistula? Just once, finish.
So It's a large size, more than 2 to 3 centimeters, associated with malignancy or radiation therapy, or associated with severe tissue loss, or with previous history of previous attempt at fistula closure.
Multiple states, foreign body.
Yes, sir. Multiple fistulas, foreign body, or if it involves the continence mechanism, like the sphincter involvement, or if there is a recto associated recto vesicle.
Intestinal fistula.
Yes.
So in one sentence.
Involvement of bladder neck also.
How it can be taken?
In continence mechanism. Yes.
Sir, in one sentence, the fistula which is of size more than 3 centimeter, distant from the cup or trigone, with history of radiotherapy or malignancy, if with history of vaginal shortening on examination, or involving the urethra, bladder neck, urethra, or intestine. That's all.
Yes.
With failed prior repair or multiple fistulas. That is another two points.
Yes.
So please remember, all of you, very clearly, and you should know in exam all yes. these things. You don't have to scratch your head to find out the causes or the difference. Fine. So now, do you know any classification which helps us to decide, you know, which fistula will behave nicely with us and which fistula will not behave?
O'Connor criteria for minimally invasive management.
Okay. So what is that? In brief,
if the fistula is less than 5 millimeter in size, and there is an oblique tract, and there is no complicating factor, then it will respond good to even
what
the endoscopic.
Else? And therapy. What else?
Circumferential involvement of the serous fistula.
Yeah.
And if the tract is matched.
Not affecting the continence mechanism.
Continence mechanism.
Yes.
No? So these are the four criteria you have to always remember. Okay, where, right?
So you know yes. classification. So, you know the classification as per involvement of continence mechanism or not?
If you know, please tell us the classification. Otherwise, we'll tell you.
Yes.
Don't know.
So there are three types as per the involvement of continence mechanism. Type one is not involving the continence mechanism. Okay.
Yes.
Type two. Involving the continence mechanism. In that two, there is A, not involving the total urethra. B, it is involving the total urethra.
Yes.
Third is miscellaneous, that is urethrovaginal fistula. This is the question.
Didact. Okay.
Yes.
Understood?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
Again, the classification based on clinical examination one may have. So high fistula, mid vaginal fistula, and low fistula. Urethrovaginal fistula. High fistula is again juxta cervical fistula or vesica uterine fistula. Low fistula is bladder neck involved fistula, either total or partial. That is two types again. Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
So high, low, and mid is basic classification with urethrovaginal fistula. Low is again involvement depend upon the bladder neck involvement. It may be not involved, it may be partially involved, it may be completely.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Understood? So please remember this type. Why I am telling you this in exam, examiner may ask you, may not ask you, that is a different thing. But in your practice, whenever you come across a fistula and you want to decide whether you can do it or not, these criteria are very, very, very important for your practice. So you should, when you start your practice, you have to decide which, if you have not done many, or you have not assisted many, you will decide which fistula you will do repair on your own, or which fistula you will not do alone, or which fistula you will send it away. So these are very important things.
Yes.
Okay. So now
bilateral stenting. This is the
Yes,
but is there any indication for isolated digestion?
He is doctor.
If the surgeon is suspicious of the any ureteric injury intraoperatively, they can put digestion at that same time. if suspecting any small uretric injury.
Gopal, 1 minute. Dr. Dite is asking you very simple. Whatever we are showing or whatever we are doing, it may not be very ideal. Please understand. Never think that if I am showing you any case, you should not think that this is the way it should be done. And that is the reason we are showing all these things. You okay? So yes, he is asking you one question that you have seen that first cystoscopy was done. There was no digestenting done.
Huh.
Now you are seeing the cystoscopy where digestenting is done. He is asking you whether you will do this or it is required or it is not required.
It is not required.
Required, which are the conditions?
It is not required in the routine cases, sir.
Okay.
If we are suspecting the any fistula is a near ureteric orifice or involving ureteric orifice, then we can place the digestion.
But that can be placed while doing the final surgery also. Is it not?
I was asking that preoperatively, is there any specific indication?
Sir, if there is any associated uretrovaginal fistula, so preoperatively we can...
Obviously, for uretrovaginal fistula, if you are suspecting uretrovaginal fistula, the first treatment of any uretrovaginal fistula is for at least single endoscopic prior to placing the digestion.
Yes.
That is true. Here, bilateral digestenting, probably they have placed as a part of final treatment, and final treatment will come later on. Okay. So, indication of bilateral fissure, only bilateral fissure.
Sir, if the patient is not fit for surgery, it is a comorbid malignancy-induced fistula, then we can do the diversion as a bilateral PCA.
Yes. Permanent nature should be explained to the patient. It is a permanent. Another is poor nutritional status. Remaining lifespan is very less. Yes. And malignant fistula. In such patients, a bilateral fistula can be placed, but the complication of associated with bilateral fistula, that is maintenance of the fistula, leakage, skin exploration, sudden fall off, all problems are there. So that is also not a easy job. Another thing is
when you will do temporary PCN?
Yes, that is question again.
Sir, if there is a huge loss of ureter in case of uretrovaginal fistula.
Okay.
So if we are planning the surgery after 3 to 6 months, so during that period we can put a PCN for the kidney.
Bilateral PCN?
So if it is bilateral fistula, then you can put a bilateral.
I am asking about vesicovaginal fistula. Is there any role of bilateral PCN?
Temporary.
Multiple failed attempts. If the previous failed attempts are there, then we can put the PCN and we can try after the some period of time. In the radiation induced fistula also, if we have to wait for the period, we can do the diversion.
If the urine leak is causing severe excoriation or there is a repeated...
That diversion should not be in terms of the DJ, because post-radiation already there is a associated cystitis, prostatitis, small capacity.
That will cause immaturity.
Yes. Then urgency, urge incontinence, stained symptoms, n number of problems are there. So the diversion in case of, if you at all it is required in case of the post-radiation, vesicovaginal fistula, is the supra-vesical diversion in terms of the
PCN. Yes, sir.
So here we will the size of the fistula told on the CT scan is near about 5 millimeter.
Yes, sir.
What are the indication for conservative management with continuous bladder drainage?
Size of fistula, sir, less than 5 millimeter, up to 5 millimeter.
Up to 5 millimeter. Okay.
Yeah, it is an immature tract.
Then you will do conservative.
Oblique tract.
Okay.
Oblique tract.
Listen, very simple. If you place the catheter and if leakage is coming down, that is the first indication. Second indication, the fistula should be long tract, long and narrow, and oblique tract. Third is fistula should be within the 3 weeks of the incidence. The cause and the appearance of the fistula or your examination should be less than 3 weeks. Yes. Okay, and the size should be less than 1 centimeter. These are the indication for conservative management.
And the high fistula. So basically, when you are confident that there are very good chances that if I do conservative management to this patient will heal his fistula. So number one, when you are finding out very early, okay? So immediately you are going to catheterize the patient, number one. Second thing, when you know that fistula is very small, so chances are very high that it will heal. High fistula, as Dr. Gite has said. Correct? Fine?
Yes.
So the four reasons you should know when you should try it. Otherwise, it is useless. So what you will do in conservative?
Contraindication for conservative treatment, again, you must know. So exactly opposite to what you tell for him. So in conservative treatment, so what is your plan?
We'll do a cystoscopy and we'll do, so we can ablate the fistula tract by using.
You are talking about conservative. You are not talking about another.
Again, you are dividing the conservative with only continuous bladder drainage, conservative with fulguration and continuous bladder drainage, conservative with ibrin glue and continuous bladder drainage, conservative and laser welding with continuous bladder drainage. These are the conservative treatments. Okay, so only conservative, it is the placement of the catheter, giving the anticholinergic drug, wait for 30 days, reassess. If the size is going down again, then again wait for 3 weeks. If it is going down or if it is healed, okay. If it is not improving at the end of 1 month, okay, the size is not going down or no symptomatic improvement, then we have to go for surgery. That is the only conservative with continuous bladder drainage. As far as fulguration is concerned, and the conservative with continuous bladder drainage, the total success rate is 3% to 30%. So,
Punish, what you will do in fulguration?
Yes.
Fulguration.
When you will do it?
If the fistula is very small, less than 5 millimeter, it's an oblique tract.
That should be without fibrosis.
Without fibrosis. And yes. So, when the fibrosis will take place? Monish, when the fibrosis will take place, after how many days?
After 6 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks.
4 to 6 weeks? 4 to 6 weeks, Gopal?
After 3 weeks, sir.
Fibrosis
after
has taken after, place, yes. You want to fulgurate. Yes.
So after 3 weeks. After 3 weeks, fibrosis takes place.
So when you fulgurate?
Within 3 weeks, sir.
So 2 to 3 weeks.
Much earlier.
Yes.
And you have found out very early because the healing has not yet started. So you want to fulgurate, so it heals by fibrosis. So what are the indications? They say actually 7 to 10 days. That should be the ideal time. 7 to 10 days, number one. How big the fistula should be?
Less than 5 millimeters. Same.
Very good, 5 millimeter. What else it should be?
Immature tract. Immature oblique tract.
Should be able to, yes. And where it should be?
It should be supra trigonal.
Very good. So please remember, these are the main when you are going to do fulguration.
Yes.
Right. Okay. What else you can do?
You can do a surgical repair of the fistula.
Before that, what else? Any other?
Fibrin glue sealant.
Yes. Yeah.
So application of laser.
Inside the fistula tract, by cystoscopically, we'll put inside
Fibrin glue should be placed vaginal. That is easy to place. That should be placed in that particular tract. Because sometimes placing the ureteric catheter across the fistula and placing the glue through cystoscopy is difficult. Not easy job. Better to place, if it is the opening is seen through vaginally, it is better to place from vaginal. With more success than transfer cycle.
Okay.
Yes. Fine. What else you can do?
Laser fulguration.
Okay. Again, the same thing. And the platelet-rich plasma?
Plasma. Yes.
What you'll do to this?
Pardon, sir? Did you?
Yeah, platelet plasma. How will you use it?
Yes.
Monish, have you seen it anytime?
Yes, sir. We'll, it is in the liquid form, so we'll inject it into the fistula tract.
Inject into fistula tract, or it will be like anti reflux this thing?
Submucosally injecting the plasma.
Yes. So what will happen? First, it will occlude, and second thing is,
it will create the
healing of the
fibrosis.
Fibrosis. Yes.
So it will help in that way. But all these things in a very small fistula.
Yes. So these are all our conservative methods. Before going to surgery, again there is a timing of the surgery.
When you will do?
So what are the when you will do the?
When you will plant, this patient has come to you. Now you will do it now. Can you do it now?
So in this case, so the fistula opening is small and the tract looks matured. There is no edema. So actually, we can plan now the procedure.
So now, if you are not done a cystoscopy, as Dr. Gita has asked you, when you will plan?
Now means after how many months? Now 2 months only.
Yes,
after 3 months, sir. After 3 months.
After 3 months for what?
Sir, to resolution of the edema.
No, Gopal, you ask answer our question very, it's a very simple question. 3 months from when? From the surgery or from the appearance of the fistula?
From the time of the surgery, sir.
Appearance
from
of the
time of surgery.
The appearance of the fistula.
I will tell you. Yeah. I will tell you. It is the timing. It is given in book. May not be applicable for a practical situation. Sometimes it is depend upon the nutritional status of the patient, then the condition of the vaginal mucosa, associated fibrosis, intraoperative on cystoscopy, bladder mucosa, then the it is the mature fistula or immature fistula. And it is just judgment. If it is identified intraoperatively, repair intraoperatively or within the 48 hour, repair immediately. Okay. Yes. Or you have to wait for 12. So last year, there is one patient in at our center. We waited for 1 year. Every time cystoscopy, there is a multiple bullous edema, medical student's mother. So we have to wait 3 months, yes. 3 months cystoscopy for having a normal like looking mucosa. We have to wait for 1 year.
Okay.
So it is not fixed case, but in the exam, at least it should be after the 3 months. Some center it will be after the 6 months. And if it is a post radiation fistula, it should be after the 12 months, but not the fixed
1 year.
12 months. Yeah.
So we have to
wait for 2 years also.
Yes.
What you will answer in exam?
After 3 months, sir.
And the examiner asks you how much time you will wait, what you will say?
And so why?
Actually, this patient will be referred to you within 1 week or 2 weeks of the leakage.
Yes.
As a neurologist. And gynecologist will be impatient. Okay. They will be worried immediately, they will say. So you'll say, okay, sir, most of the patients, they come to urologist within few days or 1 or 2 weeks of fistula. Okay, from the leakage.
Yes.
So the golden, I will like what? To build up the patient, cure the infection, and do cystoscopy after 3 months of the either surgery or leakage, and see. And I will improve the nutritional status. And if everything is fine, after minimum of 3 months, I will operate. This is your answer.
So in the exam,
infection to go away. 6 weeks given in textbook also. You have to minimum wait six weeks.
In the exam, the golden
result, you don't want failure. That's why we said 3 months.
Yes, golden period is within the 72 hour or after the 3 months. That is the best answer. So if it is within the 72 hour, I will operate immediately, or I will wait for 3 months. Some examiner will say, no, 3 months. Why 3 months? Why not 6 months?
Like gynecologist, like sir said, gynecologist will be in hurry. At that time, if you operate, you will have failure.
Yes.
So, sir, this is 6 weeks and 3 months is from the time the incontinence starts.
Yes.
Yeah, usually incontinence.
Time of the
incontinence, not surgery. not the hysterectomy.
But ultimately, it is going to be the same. Only in this case, it is after 1 month. Okay. But normally, what will happen within 5 days, 7 days, or 10 days, a fistula will come.
Correct. Yes. Well, normally, yes, within 7 to 8 days, they will manage. Sometimes in 24 to 48 hours.
Okay, sir.
Now the next question is, what method, what you want to do?
Yes, what you want to do?
We have done robot assisted.
No. Gopal, answer. Gopal, what do you like?
What he want to do?
What you want to do now?
Sir, I want to conservatively manage the patient and give the.
It has failed. Yeah. Conservative management is failed. Now, what do you want to do?
Sir, then if conservative management.
Let me ask you, Gopal. Do you think that by conservative method, this patient will improve when she has got continuous leakage? She is using 2 adult. Diapers in daytime, 2 to 3, and 1 in the night, even in the lying down position. You think that she will improve with conservative?
Very less likely, sir. Very less likely, sir.
What I told Gopal, the first indication is after placing the catheter, the incontinence should go on down significantly. Is it possible here?
No.
Then there is no question of conservative.
Yes.
So what do you like to do?
Now, the option available is surgery. Then the question is, which type of surgery?
Which surgery?
Vaginal repair.
Yeah. Which is the best, as per the book and other people, which is the best method?
Sir, vaginal repair is best for the low-lying fistula and the less complex fistula. This is less morbid also.
No. But which are the different methods of doing surgery?
By sir, transvaginally or the transabdominally or the involving the both approach.
Anything else?
So transvesically and also bivolving the bladder.
I don't know, but some of the literatures are showing that transvesical gives the best result. That is what I have read in some papers. I'm not very sure on that. So what are the three methods? Transvaginal, transvesical, and
both involving the both approach.
No, so abdominal.
Yes. Huh? Abdominal. Yes.
So if abdominal asks you what you will do,
so you answer what you like to do.
Your answer should be either I will do a laparoscopic VWAP repair or robotic VWAP repair. I will do abdominal modified O'Connor repair. That is my answer in exam.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in this case, the fistula is not very high up, and also there is a previous abdominal surgery. So, is it better to go for transvaginal?
Advantages of transvaginal surgeries are what? So, Monish, tell me 1, 2, 3, 4.
Theoretically, the indication for vaginal repair and abdominal repair are defined already. But nowadays, as per the literature, including my one paper in obstetric and gynecology journal, it is depend upon if you are expert in doing the abdominal surgery, you can repair all the fistulas by abdominal surgery. If you are expert in repairing the by vaginal route, then you can able to repair all the fistulas by vaginal. So it is depend upon the technical skill, expertise of the surgeon.
Dr. Gite,
yes, sir.
In your corollary, I will tell you, two different times, 2004 and 2008, our Mumbai Urology Society had arranged for a female urology, means conference. Okay. And Shobo Raj, who has done more than 4,500 to 5,000, he is considered as a father of this surgery.
Yes.
He is doing any surgery, whether simple, complex, you know, third time, fourth time, he is doing only transvaginal surgeries.
That's what I have asked him.
Okay, as you said very rightly, it depends in which method you are very good.
Sir, I have done near about 60-70 vesicovaginal fistulas, all sizes and all numbers, 2, 3, supratrigonal, infratrigonal, near to bladder neck, only by the modified O'Connor.
Yes.
Abdominal. Correct. It is possible for me. That's what the conclusion of my paper also.
Correct.
So, but theoretically in exam, and that can be supported. Whatever you are and me telling is that can be supported by current literature. Then number of papers have conclusion. It is depend upon the expertise and the experience of the surgeon.
There are some indication where you can do only one particular surgery.
Yeah.
Okay. Then it is okay. Yeah. Like you can say, okay, you want to do re-implantation of ureter.
Yeah.
Said you cannot do transvaginal surgery.
Yes. Sir.
Yes.
So Gopal, can you let us go step by step? Gopal, how will you do transvaginal surgery?
Sir, the Ladzo repair by the or the RAS repair are mentioned for the transvaginal repair.
RAS is a Somo RAS, correct?
Somo, yes. Sir.
Yes. So how he does it?
Sir, these are three to four layer repair without the transecting the fistula.
Tell me step by step.
Sir, the first layer will be the mucosal layer from inside. Then
how will you start here?
Sir, the
how Somo RAS is doing?
You only teach us. We don't know.
Okay. I'll tell you. He has listened. He has developed one instrument which is similar to the this thing, right angle mixture type of instrument, but its tips are little longer and it's very sharp. So what he does, like a dilator, slowly he puts per urethra because bladder is totally empty. So he will put it per urethral and the tip pointing towards the abdomen, and it will puncture the abdomen and it will come out. So he will open it up, take one Foley's catheter and pull it inside and pull it out from the urethra, and then he will keep it into the bladder. So the suprapubic is done. Okay. After that, he will take artery forceps, go on a fistula, dilate it and put a 12 French Foley's catheter, inflate balloon, and he will pull the vagina down. Now, as you know, what is the position? Lithotomy position, extended lithotomy position, all these things you should know.
Yes.
After that, he will do the dissection. So as you are saying, because there is a balloon inside the bladder and the full bladder as well as the vagina has been pulled down. So he will dissect vaginal wall and the bladder separately. And he will take the suture, correct? If he is taking bladder vertically, after that, he will put an artery forceps inside, hold the peritoneum and pull it down and put it between the two layers. And then he will suture vagina in a horizontal level. And for that, most of the time, he is using for the vagina 330 Vicryl and for bladder 40. After that, he puts methylene blue inside the bladder and wait for some time to see whether there is any leakage or not, and then he'll stop everything and come out. Understood? This is the way he is doing.
Yes.
And if there is enough of place, he will take vertical as well as a transverse stitches over the bladder. So three layer in that case. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, as far as exam is concerned, if your center is doing regularly with the vaginal route, you must tell vaginal route only.
Yes.
If your center is doing abdominal O'Connor, you tell abdominal O'Connor. If your center is doing laparoscopy, then tell, I am accustomed with the laparoscopic VWA repair, I have skin, I have assisted, I will tell laparoscopy.
Yes.
So, but whatever you know in detail, that should be the answer in exam.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, Monish.
Yes.
So how will you do transvesical, and then how will you do open? Tell me.
Transvesical. So one is the Ladzo repair, which so we just denude the mucosa for 2 to 3 millimeter below the fistula opening, and we just close the vagina. It's called the call. Yeah, and then we close the mucosa over the. So that's a Ladzo technique, but it causes the vaginal shortening. So it's not preferred in a young patient or who's planning to have sexual intercourse. And second is, sir, the split flap technique, in which, sir, we go transvaginally. We separate the anterior and the posterior vaginal mucosal flaps. And there's no need to excise the entire fistula tract. We close the bladder part of the fistula in a horizontal manner. Then, so we place a either a peritoneum or we can take a Marsh's flap, which is from the fibrofatty tissue from the vulva, and we place it in between the bladder and the vagina. Mm-hmm. And then we close the vagina in a perpendicular fashion, not in the same horizontal as the bladder mucosa. And so we keep the SPC as well as the urethral catheter in the postoperative period. And so before removing the periurethral catheter, we do a cystography and then remove the catheter. And the patient is passing urine well, then after that we can remove the suprapubic catheter.
So you are explaining transvesical repair.
Yes.
Okay. So can anybody explain
the abdominal? Gopal, can you tell?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. The
okay.
Transabdominal, sir. We will.
Which incision will start with that? What position you will give to the patient?
Sir, supine position, sir. In the
supine position, have you seen? Tell me very clearly.
No, sir. We will do in the lithotomy position with the financial incision.
Financial
or the lower midline incision.
What surgery you want to do?
Open abdomen.
Open abdomen.
Doing open.
Extraperitoneal, yes, transperitoneal.
Transperitoneal.
You are going transperitoneal.
Who has yes. used the first abdominal route for treating the VVF? Is it O'Connor or anybody, somebody?
O'Connor, sir?
No.
Gilbert?
No. It is a Trendle number. Who has done a first abdominal repair for VVF in 1888? Now, as far as the O'Connor repair is concerned, nowadays, two, three important things. First is
modification.
So it is a bladder is bivalved vertically or open horizontally. Now the area of discussion currently is it horizontal opening of the bladder or it vertical opening of the bladder? Is it complete opening of the bivalving of the bladder or it is limited opening of the bladder like the leg? So all these modifications people were doing, but their long term comparative results here is not available right now. It is as per the
individual
ways they have thought or they have they are doing since years. It is possible. Each have some pros and cons. Like if short cystotomy, not involving the superior border or the dome, only on the posterior wall of the bladder, explained by the Dalila, that is called as limited cystotomy. Then people are doing horizontal opening of the bladder in case of the laparoscopy as well as in robotic surgeries, because access to the fistula is direct and suturing is very easy while doing by the laparoscopy and robotic. So each one is not compared with one another, and it is dependent on the person who is doing and how he is accustomed with that particular technique. That is one.
Yes.
Another thing is excision of the fistula tract and not excision of the fistula tract. Again, few people will tell that they will excise the fistula tract. Few people will tell they will not excise the fistula tract. So what are the indication of excision of the fistula tract and what are the benefits of not excising the fistula tract? Tell me.
The malignancy, if the suspicion of the malignant fistula, then the excision of the tract should be done.
Dekho, routinely, the nowadays people are not doing the excision of fistula tract because it will increase the size of the fistula. Okay. Another
yes.
thing, if you are not excised the fistula, then the suture will do fibrosis will help in maintaining the sutures. That are the indications. If indications for removing the fistula stack is if the patient had a prior history of malignancy. That suppose that histopathology of that hysterectomy suggests of malignancy. However, some that if it is a fistula is of malignant variety, that if then the excision of the tract, if it is helping in staging giving the staging information, when there is a known malignancy in that particular patient, that means malignant fistula. In such situation, the excision is required, but routinely the excision of fistula is not required. Third question which
yes,
will come in exam is the diversion. It is the only periurethral diversion. It is a supravesical only diversion. So SPC or SPC plus PUC. whatever it's doing at your center, you tell. Because if it is, if you tell only POC, okay, no problem. If you tell SPC plus POC, you have to defend it. Because at our place, we were placing both the things, that SPC and POC. So the reason behind that is additional security. If suppose accidentally peripheral catheter fallen off, if suppose peripheral catheter has got blocked in the night, the resident is not there, it will cause a problem to a repair. So additional, for giving the additional diversion, SPC we are placing, and by placing the SPC additionally, there is not any increase in benefit compared to the peripheral catheter alone. So it is individual, and the reason what we were telling is additional security to avoid the mishaps. So these are the two, three important. Another important thing is dissection between the fistula, bladder and the vagina. So you must tell ki the bladder and the area between the vagina and bladder should be dissected at least 1 to 1.5. What we were doing is 2 centimeter, 1.5 to 2 centimeter, dissect all around, so that the suture, taking the suture is easy. One, and another thing is placing the second layer there in terms of the omentum or peritoneum or sigmoid, appendicular, epicloacy, or some gracilis or whatever available there, or transverse rectus abdominis, as per flap, as per the site and size of the fistula. We have to decide that. That is the dissection between the vagina and bladder should be at least more than 1.5 centimeter all around. That is another.
Yes.
And, then what you incorporate in between, examiner may ask, then you must know okay, what are the things available there.
So Gopal, what you will do, which now in, I want to finish this in 2 minutes, your surgery. Dr. Gita has explained you everything. So what, which position you will give?
We will give the low lithotomy position, sir. With the insertion of the catheter.
Modified lithotomy position?
Yes, sir. Modified lithotomy position, sir.
Why? With the extended legs?
Yes, sir.
And you put a sandbag below the ring?
Sandbag.
Sacrum. Why?
Sir, it will lift the...
One, in open surgery, you want one of the assistant to stand between the two legs. So he can, yes, or she can help you out.
Yes.
Correct? In retraction, yes, and everything. Second thing is you want pelvis to be tilted.
Yes, sir.
So that it is facing upward and medially. Okay?
Yes.
So you can see it very clearly. You want that pelvis to be tilted. Right? Which incision you will take?
Sir, lower midline incision.
Why lower midline incision?
Good exposure of the entire bladder.
And what else? What you are going to put in between?
So peritoneum or omentum.
Omentum. So omentum, if you want, yes, and if your omentum is short, then omentum is long. So then, in how many percentage of people?
In the 50%, around 50 to 60% patients.
70. But yes, 30% patients may have short omentum. So what you will do?
Yes.
So we can mobilize it over the gastroepiploic artery.
Very good. So if you take
penetrating right
incision, can you do all these things?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No. So what incision? Midline incision. If required, you can extend it. Okay?
Yes.
Now what,
yes,
now what you'll do once you go inside?
So we'll open the bladder vertically.
Yes. So before that, and what you take?
Stay sutures over the anterior wall of the
totally. So two stay sutures you will take.
Yes.
How will you find out bladder? It is totally empty.
We will fill with the...
yes, okay.
We'll,
you try to fill. If the fistula is small, you may get. But what else is there?
We will pack the vagina, sir. We have to pack the vagina.
How will you find out a bladder?
So when the Foley's bulb can be palpable.
So you inflate the Foley's bulb.
Yes.
Okay, you can inflate it to 30, 40 cc also.
Yes.
And you just,
yes,
little push inside and you'll be able to,
yes,
fill,
sir,
it. So yes, when you fill it, you hold that part of the bladder and take this case sutures.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, now what you'll do?
So we take the stay sutures and then open the bladder vertically between the stay sutures.
Okay.
So we'll see the fistula.
Some people who are saying transverse, some people are saying vertical. Some people are saying only small incision, some people are saying right up to the, so you'll bivalve it. Okay?
Yes. Yes.
And what you'll do? You'll go up to what level?
So we'll go about 2 to 3 centimeter distal to the opening of the fistula.
No, you will go up to the fistula, na? You will open up the full fistula, na? Now,
yes,
okay.
Yes.
Now, what you'll do?
Then we'll separate the vagina from the.
So, how will you identify the vagina?
So we'll place a sponge stick in the vagina.
Yes, so good. That is why you require one assistant lower down also who can really retract the everything, even the suprapubic part as well as with one hand, he will push the vagina, so you will be able to see the vaginal anterior vaginal wall. Okay, now what you'll do?
Then, so the mucosa, bladder mucosa, the bladder we can close in two layers, the mucosa so and then the muscle.
It, nah? First you'll dissect it. Nah?
Dissect the fistula tract completely.
So what you'll dissect?
So closing of the bladder again, in single layer, two layer, doesn't matter.
Sir, we'll talk to that, but let me ask them how they will separate the bladder and vagina.
Yes.
Yes.
So with the sharp dissection and whatever, you are going to go between the vagina and bladder.
Yes.
Okay? Minimum of 5 millimeter to 6, at least once I go up to 1 centimeter. So that I can take up one or two stitches very easily over the vagina.
If you are going in right plane, there will not be any bleeding.
Yes.
If there is bleeding, that means you are going more towards the vagina.
Yeah.
Vagina.
Yes.
Okay.
Vagina is highly vascular structure.
Yes. So now question is, what is a good repair?
So it should be tension free. It should be in multiple layers. It should be well vascularized. Flap which we put in between the two structures. It should and be watertight.
Watertight and hemostasis should be achieved.
Hemostasis is perfect and the suture line should not overlap.
So where do you put the knots? In the bladder? In the bladder or outside the bladder? Again, this is controversial, but
it should be outside the bladder.
What?
Knot? Knot should be inside or outside?
You can put inside also because we are using an absorbable suture.
Inside only. Many books and all say okay, ideally you should put it inside because that knot otherwise will cause a pressure necrosis. There are chances and it will get an infected also. But if you put the knot inside, you are using which material? Absorbable. So
absorbable.
It will fall down and it will come out in urine. So some examiner will ask you, normally I am doing that. Okay, so what are the five criteria of good suturing or fistula repair? Number one,
watertight,
good mobilization. Yes. Number
principle.
Two,
tension-free suture. Prepare.
Yes.
Tension-free suture, watertight suture, good vascularity, proper hemostasis achieved.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Now,
yes,
sir. Dr. Gite asks you, do you excise the tract or the margin? Do you excise?
No.
So not required in all cases.
Whether you are doing or not, your hospital doing or not.
No, sir.
Not doing.
Say, no, sir, we are not doing it.
Yes.
You have to be very clear in exam. No, sir, we are not doing it. Okay?
Yes.
Now, how many layers you are suturing? Tell me very frankly if you have seen it. One or two or...
Single layer.
I am doing it single layer because at lower end I am not able to get two layers.
Yes. So it is very difficult.
So say whatever you are doing in your hospital. Okay.
Yes.
So how will you suture? Which material you will use for vagina?
So Vicryl 30.
Okay, and you will cut the knot. I mean, very near. You will keep the or you will keep the.
So short. We will keep the shorter. We will keep.
normally we
won't cause
all the three very long, so that after taking few stitches on bladder, we take the omentum, okay, and the take the stitch, those three stitches are there on the vagina, we put a needle on that and we take a stitch through omentum, so that omentum goes right till the separation of bladder and vagina. You understand,
sir? What we were doing is, in spite of taking the three long sutures, at the closure of valve, we are dissecting between the vagina and bladder near about 1.5 centimeter distally, and taking a transverse stitch on the antrovaginal wall. Behind the bladder. That stitch, in that stitch, again come through the omentum, so that the omentum will go between the bladder and vagina.
So what I do is, I take the one stitch as you are doing,
and
the vagina.
Yes.
But these another two stitches, it will hold the omentum very nicely.
Agreed, sir.
So that is what the extra thing we do. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Gopal, now what you are going to suture? Continuous or interrupted stitches?
Sir, interrupted, sir.
In bladder?
Doesn't matter.
In bladder, we can take the continuous, and in the vagina, interrupted suture.
Initially, in the bladder, what type of suture you will take? Interrupted or continuous?
Sir, initially interrupted suture, sir.
Interrupted. That is why you are saying not will be inside.
Yes.
Otherwise, there is no need to say like that.
Yes, sir.
Which vicryl you will use, or you will use catheter?
Vicryl 20.
20 for bladder?
So 30 or 40?
No. 20. Please, in example, 20 for vagina and 30-40 for the bladder. As per the mood of the exam, better to tell 40 and 20 is for the vagina.
Yes.
Okay, next question you will come is, how many days you will place the catheter?
Yes.
For 1 month, sir. 4 weeks to Five. 6 weeks.
For the catheter?
3 weeks.
If 3 weeks. To remove the blastone, you place
1 week.
So here, how many weeks?
So 3 weeks we will keep the catheter.
1 week, and the SPC is for the more than that, and we have to see the any leakages there.
If you are placing the SPC and PUC, tell me periotal catheter when you are removing.
After 1 week.
Should be 2 weeks. If it is 1 week. In your center, tell 1 week. And you must be keeping the SPC open.
Yes.
If you are removing the peritoneal catheter at the end of 1 week, then you may be keeping the SPC open for next how many weeks?
3 weeks, sir.
Yes. So that means at the end of 4 weeks, you are doing either cystography.
Cystography, sir.
Correct. If there is no leak, you are clamping the SPC. Asking how to pass the urine, if he is passing urine well and good, then you are removing the SPC. That may be the protocol at your institute. Correct?
Yes.
But in the exam, the answer for removal of the PUC is after the 2 weeks.
Okay. Dinesh, tell me when the leakage will take place?
Pardon, sir? Can't you?
When the leakage will take place? Recurrence or leakage?
So after the catheter removal.
No, when it will take place, when do you notice the failure?
Overactive, sir, over distended bladder.
Failure. When the failure you will see?
After the catheter removal, when the patient will void it.
Think a very simple question. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 10 days, 15 days, 21 days.
Sir, after
when
one
the line month, will give way.
After
when you are sure that now weeks. There will not be any leakage most of the time.
So about 2 weeks.
Within, see, the leakage, the recurrence of fistula takes place in the second week.
Yes.
That is why everyone is saying that more than 14 days. Some people remove on 17, 18 day, both. Even if they first day remove periurethral catheter, as Dr. Gitesh said, then keep for 1 or 2 days, clamp it. Okay. Yes. Then patient passes urine very well, you can do cystogram and remove it. So like 18 day, you can remove periurethral catheter. After 14-15 days, you remove periurethral catheter. 2 days you drain suprabubically, then you clamp it. There is no leakage. You do, if you want, you can do
cystogram.
Cystogram, and then remove.
Yes.
Understood.
If you don't want to do the cystogram, then at the end of 4 weeks you just remove the catheter.
Yes.
If you are placing only periurethral catheter, then the protocol should be you should be kept up to near about 3 to 4 weeks.
Yeah.
Then with cystogram or without cystogram, you have to remove the catheter. If you are not doing the cystogram, then you have to assess for the pain in abdomen and fever, if there is a leak or not.
Yes.
Okay. If there is no symptoms, then it's well and good. And so for examiner may ask, if you place only periurethral catheter, then what is the protocol? And examiner may ask, if it is SPC plus PUC, then what is the protocol? So what you should know both the protocol.
Yes. But if you are putting suprapubic catheter and you put the periurethral catheter, and if you keep both open, from where urine will come?
Yes. Sir, from the suprapubic catheters.
Why?
It will come from both the.
Yes.
It will come from both, but you will be surprised. Many a time, patient will tell you, sir, I am passing only from suprapubic. And what is the reason?
Sir, what?
Because what happens, sir, that the balloon, it will keep the
balloon.
Yes, the higher
bladder neck.
Yes, and if the Foley's catheter suprabubic is right up to the bladder wall down, usually it will drain all the urine. You understand? So that is what can happen.
So
that is why people are saying suprabubic is a better drainage than periurethral.
Yes.
Yes.
So, what are the causes for recurrence?
If
at all it is occur.
Infection, the non-overriding suture lines.
Causes is related to the patient. Causes is related to the surgery.
Related to patients, what are the...
Diabetes, sir. Diabetes, there is an infection.
One is diabetes and infection.
And so the nutritional deficiency.
Nutritional, very good.
Atherosclerosis.
Yes. Then
compromised.
Yes. Compromised. Immunocompromised status.
Okay.
And the surgery related is a inadequate mobilization. No use of the interposition flaps. No watertight suturing.
Tension on the suture and
all the five things which are the ideal, you are saying that the ideal thing is not done. Those five things points.
Then plus if any fistula is missed, a small
fistula is missed, very good. Then
you have to associate
it.
Yes.
Okay. Then
so premature removal of catheter.
Okay. Or what else?
Foley is irritating the suture line, sir.
So it is
bladder spasm.
Yes.
Bladder
spasm, infection.
So that may be the another question examiner may ask it. Do you regularly using the anticholinergic post operative?
Yes.
If you are using, you tell yes. And reason is bladder to avoid the bladder spasm. If you are not using, then you tell no. But that may be asked.
Yes.
Okay, so these are the causes for recurrence, and what advice at the time of discharge you will give to the patient?
So avoid sexual intercourse for 3 months.
First advice is pass urine frequently.
Yes.
Second advice is avoid sexual intercourse for next 3 months.
Yes.
Third advice is
avoid pregnancy.
Avoid pregnancy for 1 year.
Yes.
Fourth thing is, if at all pregnancy occurs, tell your
C-section.
LSCS. Yes.
Elective surgery in section. These are the advices you give at the time of discharge.
Yes.
Yes.
So all these things probably the finishing.
Yes, I think we were supposed to take one urethrovaginal.
I'll just say, actually, sir, now we are not sure whether our exam is going to be this regular pattern or OSCE pattern. So, but I just wanted to say that in OSCE, whenever there are tables, we are actually in our case presentation covering most of the topics. Like there will be one question which will be, how will you ask history? So we have already discussed that.
Yes.
In this patient. The next table will be, how will you counsel this patient for surgery? The examiner will be observing you while you are counseling the patient for surgery. So that we have not discussed. How will you counsel? Other than that, there will be one table of CT urography, and they will ask you or name the abnormality or something like that. Objective questions. We have again discussed that. Cystoscopy photos can be placed, and they will ask you what type of fistula, what surgery you will do.
So that we have done.
We have discussed.
So now, Ganesh, only one thing is left. How will you counsel this patient for surgery? So what you will tell?
Sir, counseling. Sir, if we are delaying the surgery for 3 months, then we will explain the patient that why we have to wait for 3 months, and then after the surgery, then
so how do we will require a patient has got lots of problem.
First, you will explain the patient what is the problem. Then you will
yes, sir. Sir, so explain that there is a.
First of all, Ganesh, tell me whom we will counsel.
So the patient as well as the husband.
Husband, exactly. Yes. Because what happens, you don't realize. If you come across now from the village and town, these people are, you know, they will just leave their wife. They are not interested because she is continuously false smelling urine.
Very severe social stigma, a lot of problems, divorces, or a number of problems.
So,
psychological depression.
Yes. So, you will counsel the husband, family members, and the patient. What you will tell to the husband?
So that due to the previous surgery, there has been an abnormal communication from the urinary tract.
Then you will to the gynecologist.
The sir, we will not tell like that.
Counseling should will be started at the identification intraoperatively. If at all it is intraoperative, people were very angry outside. They were blaming the gynecologist. You have to convince the gynecologist. You have to convince the patient relative, we have to assure them that I will make you incontinence free, don't worry. Because otherwise, they will go and hit the gynecologist. That's what happened many times.
Yeah.
In the periphery.
So, how will you counsel husband, first of all, family members? What you will tell?
Very nicely put it on the chat. That is very important. In counseling, because the natural course of the disease, severity, classification, disease problem. Management options and best recommendation.
One thing is missing is complications. Certain complications have to be.
Yeah.
Complications as far as this surgery is concerned, not too many, except we have to explain about the recurrence. Then we have to explain about the complication in terms of the vaginal complications like dyspareunia. There are reported literature which shows. Sexual dysfunction in the females.
Yeah.
That is a decrease in the lubrication, then dyspareunia, then difficulty in doing the sexual intercourses. If you are gone by vaginal route, and if you are gone by abdominal route, then immediate complications like bleeding, leakage, and long-term complications. If you are not assessed the bladder adequately, if there is a small size bladder and if you repaired it, and it will post-operatively behave like a low capacity high pressure bladder patient have a long-term urgent content or urgency. So these are the probable sequelae of the surgery. So you have to tell everything before doing the surgery, and if required, if the size of the fistula is large, then you have to again augment the bladder in spite of going only for the repair. Yes, that is a requirement.
Yes, sir.
Correct. So I will tell you in short how you are going to counsel. First of all, bring all the family members and the husband and tell them that this is not her problem. This is not her disease. Sometime in this surgery, during birth or during removal of the uterus, these structures are very nearby, and by naturally they are so much adherent, and sometimes that after doing surgery, the blood supply may decrease. This is the way I say, the blood supply may decrease and this fistula will take place. So by that you are protecting the other side. Okay.
Yes.
And you are telling them that this is not her fault. And she's then you explain them that how much she is suffering. So we have to help her. We are going to help her. And how I'm going to help, that I will now tell them, plus to the patient. See, this is a problem. I'm going to do this particular surgery. Most of the time till now, I operated so many cases. Everyone has gone home very happily. 99% or 90% there are chances nothing will happen. But there are some chances that you may develop infection, you may have recurrence, or you may have all these things. But don't worry, everything will be fine. So you explain them everything like that, counsel them. So in exam also you do the same thing. Then examiner is happy.
Yes, sir. Yes. Okay. This is a short case I have taken from Dr. Prakash of JJ. It is JJ's first case only. This is just to discuss again little bit OSCE style. So in short, this patient also had incontinence since 2 years. She has undergone hysterectomy. Histopathology report was negative for malignancy. And after 5 days of hysterectomy, she developed incontinence. Catheter was reinserted. But after 5 days of catheter removal, again she had leakage. So 20 days later, she underwent some vaginal procedure. Still symptoms persisted. Then abdominal procedure.
Same patient, what I told.
Yes, sir.
We have to wait for 1 year.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So abdominal procedure was done after 2 weeks and bilateral stent was kept. And so the stent was removed after 4 months. Again, she started having incontinence. So I'm just going to show you the CT scan and you answer the questions OSCE style. This Gopal, you answer. The next thing, Akshay can answer. Okay. Can you see the video?
Yeah.
Yeah, and the next one.
The same one. Yeah. Okay. It's the same one.
Yeah.
Any vertical you have seen?
No, sir. Vertical is not there.
Okay. So, yes. One of you can answer. What is it?
And cystoscopy finding, I will tell. For first 3 times, first 2 times, I am not able to see ureteric opening. Everything, everywhere there is ragged mucus.
Correct.
Nothing is it. Whole trigone is like irregular bullous edema everywhere, no ureteric opening except left side ureteric opening I am able to see. So to identify and to heal that particular area, I have to wait near about 1 year.
Yes, sir.
And just 1 week before we remove the catheter successfully and she is passing urine. Great. Just 1 week before. She is from Nandurbar.
Okay, sir. So now in this CT scan, if you have to ask OSCE type questions, it will be like this, 2 marks each. One, spot the diagnosis. So Monish,
I couldn't see the fistulas opening clearly.
Okay, should I play it or should I just show you the report now? The CT IVP positive of left kidney calculus 0.5 centimeter and in left distal ureter 4 to 6 centimeters from VUJ, there is a uretero-vaginal fistula. Okay, so it is a left uretero-vaginal fistula.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's okay. Classification we have already discussed, the types of fistulas in our history during the previous case. So let's forget this
question. Yeah.
What is the optimal window period after which CT scan should be done for such a patient?
Immediately.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Gaurang sir, Gita sir, okay with the answer?
Yeah, if you are suspecting, whenever the patient comes for the leak, you can't say, I will do it after 1 week, 2 weeks.
If you are suspecting uretrovaginal fistula either with VVF or without VVF, whatever the thing you have to do is do it immediately.
Standard of care, it can be done now. Yeah. What is the point?
Yes.
And the next question is, what is the adjunctive test and surgery, both, that you would do before planning the definitive surgery?
Again, urethroscopy.
One mark each.
Cysto urethroscopy and the vaginoscopy.
Plus, and
RGP.
Yes, sir. The DG stenting, yes.
So RGP, no? Diagnosis.
Cystoscopy, yes, RGP,
vaginoscopy.
Plus minus RGP, if at all required, then DG stenting. Yes. The same patient had associated vasovaginal fistula also.
Yes.
Yes.
This patient had vasovaginal fistula also. That is identified after the third scopy, 3 months, after 3 months, 3 months, 3 months. Yes. And not able to place the guide wire across the ureteric opening. I tried initially, I was not able to see the ureteric opening. Then tried for the ureteroscopy, placing the guide wire, RGP, a thing is going up. Everything is, then do the ureteroscopy. Just outside the bladder, it is communicating, probably at the hiatus of the ureter, not the meatus, hiatus of the ureter, it is going to the vagina. But
correct.
From vagina, from vaginoscopy, wire is going right into the kidney.
Okay, sir.
Yes. That is the intraoperative point.
Okay,
so, sir. What is the spot diagnosis? Now let us start again. Padapad, Monish, what is the spot diagnosis?
Uretro. So left uretrovaginal fistula. Right uretrovaginal.
Left uretrovaginal fistula, correct. But you will. There are also possibility of
with a VVF.
It is definitely, since it is the lower end of the uretrovaginal fistula, uretric fistula, I will also like to rule out vasovaginal fistula. On CT scan, you cannot be 100% sure.
Yes.
Unless and until you can see definitely from the ureter, a line of dye coming down into the vagina.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that is the only 100% diagnosis, otherwise no. Now classification of the above diagnosis. Yeah, okay, and now optimal window, you know.
Abnormality noted. 1 mark.
Actually, the lateral film was.
Yes.
Yes.
What is this? Anyways, of the same patient.
Yeah,
so
yeah. The
left UVJ.
Yes.
I mean, left fistula. Okay, then what is the name of the dye used? They can ask you this. So, sir.
Urographin.
No, that is the.
That is the trade name.
Yeah.
Sodium dietrazine.
Sodium dietrazine.
Okay, yes. They asked you percentage. So, what is the percentage?
Yes, sodium dietrazine and meglumine dietrazine. 50-50.
Correct. What are the different phases of the study? 1 mark.
The scout film and then.
Filling phase and voiding phase.
Filling phase and then the voiding.
Ideal. What is the ideal position of the patient? This can come for 1 mark.
It's oblique position. Okay. Prime position.
Yes.
So you have to write
lateral this position.
Careful. Right. You have to write
lateral. Right lateral, left lateral, oblique, and the post-foot fins in supine position.
Correct. Can this test be done with a raised creatinine or abnormal parameters?
Yeah, it can
yes.
be done.
Yes.
Correct. So this is how OSCE will be.
Yes.
Okay. So next time also, we'll last 5 minutes, 7 minutes, we'll put the questions like that. Now yes. only two so, or three.
So I will ask the question. This patient had a vesic vaginal fistula exactly involving the ureteric opening and associated urethrovaginal fistula just at the hiatus. What you will
do? Sir, we will do the repair of fistula with the simultaneous left ureteric reimplantation.
Right.
Right
ureteric reimplantation. Fine. So here, what the problem here is, it is the fistula is in the ureteric opening. Vesic vaginal fistula is in the ureteric opening. Okay. And another fistula is just at the hiatus. So dissecting the ureteric opening and the fistula sac is very difficult.
Yes.
In such situation, one has to go very close to the bladder and disconnect the ureter from there. Okay. Ligate the distal end and just bivalve the bladder and treat it like a vesic vaginal fistula.
Yes.
And reimplantation.
Correct.
Yes.
And one question they can ask in this, if there was a post-op photo, suppose they would have asked you for 2 marks. When will you remove the left DJ stent?
Yeah.
When will you remove?
6 weeks. So at 6 weeks, we'll do a RGP and then remove the DJ stent.
Yes.
Oh yeah, that's it. I think. Okay. So any more, I cannot think of any more OSCE.
No, we'll just remember next time and anything is there, we'll put it. Right, Dr. Gite, Dr. Hiren?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.